afternoon, everybody. Welcome. We're not giving away any free tickets today, so if you thought that was a place to be at, I'm sorry, it's in the room next door. So with that, we'll go ahead and get started on our docket for today. Now, first, we have first order of business is approval from the minutes from our last meeting on June 2nd, 2015. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion seconded. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Very good. Motion passes. Second, we are going to honor Denise Phillips, who I understand is going to be retiring.
Yes, she is. It's kind of a sad day for us for Denise to leave, and I'm going to make a few comments, and I'm sure the board will have some comments, but first I'd like to ask Sherry Mingwinkle to do the formal introduction.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Commissioners. Sherry Van Winkle from the Administration Division. And I'm here today to present before you Denise Phillips, who after 17 years with the city is going to retire effective June 30th. Denise started out with the city in 1998 in city planning and development. And I remember Denise from seeing her at focus meetings where she would facilitate the meetings and keep us all in order. And she was with City Planning and Development for about 7 years and then came over to Parks in 2005 and has been working very closely with our Planning and Design Services Division and contracts and contract administration for these low 10 years. And one of the big projects that Denise has worked on for a very long time is before you today, the Boulevard and Parkway Standards and Design Guidelines. Now, Denise and I have been working together all this time, but really she just reported to me for about the last year, and before that, Denise reported to Travis, and I know Travis wanted to say a few words before you today. So, Travis?
Thank you, Sher. And, I came on board here in 2011, and contracts was part of planning, and I had the honor of working with Denise through that time and through her involvement in both contracts and HRD related issues. And one of the things I appreciated the most working with Denise was that she didn't need an interpreter when working with me. So growing up in Southeast Missouri and taking English as a second language when I took university, she knew what I meant when I said finer than frog hair. You know? Or that contract's rough as a cob. It needs a little more refinement. Or your bucket's got a hole in it. You know, you better reinforce your story before you go on there. So certainly appreciate that. Appreciate working with you.
And with that, I'll turn it over to the director to say what he would like to say. Or would you like to hear from Denise first?
Let's maybe the other commissioner might want to say something first.
Okay.
Where would like to go first? Go ahead.
It's been great to work with you. I was sad to see that you're leaving, but wish you all the best. I've really enjoyed working with you and been a great asset to the department, and very much enjoyed working with you on these design guidelines and your spirit and all that for the Parks Department and everything it stands for. So thank you for everything you've done.
My first comment to Mark was, how could you let this happen? But I understand time comes to to retire and move on. I haven't reached that time yet. I'm sorry that you have, but it's been a pleasure working with you these 3 years.
Yes, to second both of those, and just to thank you for your responsiveness, always willing to hop to, and it just really has been a pleasure. So thank you for those years of service.
I thought there must be a different Denise Phillips. I said, that's not her. It can't be. I look over there, and it's really you. I said, oh, man. So, no, you've made my few months here on the Parks Board truly a pleasure, and I really appreciated seeing your face, whatever would be in the community or here at meetings. I appreciated your smile and your reassurance and helped me not feel as dumb as I felt the first couple of weeks I was here. So thank you for everything, and congratulations on the retirement.
Yeah.
And Denise, you and I know each other way before I joined the board here. And so, you know, you've been a great friend, and I know you'll continue to be, and I look forward to seeing what you do next. You are truly the embodiment of what is all great about this department and this city, and we thank you for your years of service. So, thank you.
Denise, you're leaving. Okay. I think it was, and I look back on the date of 2005, and that's probably about when Vicki Notice called me. And he's running city planning, of course, was the chief architect and planner behind Focus. And focus wasn't going to be going quite the way it had gone in the past, and so Denise fortunately came to our department, and I know you've left city service since that time as well, Vicki, so good to see you here today. And it is a little bit shallow, a bit of irony, I guess, that we have a Boulevard and Parkway standing before the board today. I think Mr. Bowers reminded us a couple meetings ago, we've been doing this about 7 years, so it looks like it's about 3 years since you started. We put you on the Boulevard and Parkway stand, so you've been living there for 7 years, and this is a step in that process today. So a lot of your work, and you've been the person primarily behind those efforts over those 7 years, and you will be missed, and as you know, we've got a little further to go, but this is a milestone in that whole process. Also, one thing I want to acknowledge is that Denise is a good user of our facilities, her family, whether it's at the community centers or at the Riding Academy up at Camp Lake of the Woods, so she's kind of a first-time user for her family. That's very important to us. Another thing that Denise has done a great job of is working with Phil Yelder and his department, the Fairness and Construction Board, working through that, our relationship with Phil. Phil wasn't there at that time, but working through the MBWB process and Fairness and Construction. I think of Commissioner Jama Webster, who was on the board at that time and trying to build that strong relationship, and I think that'll be truly missed. And you know, working with Phil and Ashley Blue, we got their contracting group coming up in August and things like that, and so that's a tough void to fill, to make sure we set the goals right and follow through and kind of work through some of those issues. So that's important to us. Obviously working with Travis for the first past several years, and of course working with Sherry, and contracts are a big part of what we do here. And whether it's working construction design contracts or relationship building contracts, there's another item on the agenda. Bobby's here today, working through that contract. And so it's tough, you know, obviously that sensitivity for the neighborhoods and understanding the neighborhoods, what the neighborhood's concerns are, and that's a big part of what we do as well. And so glad to see some of your other familiar faces here today as well.
Would you like to say a few words?
Sure.
Please.
Never miss an opportunity to talk.
It's my training. I just want to say I'm so happy that there are people here who have worked with me through the years, and people here from the neighborhoods. It is kind of the perfect storm that the Boulevard and Parkway standards are basically up for maybe your final consideration today. I think Mr. Bowers just came to make sure I was really leaving. But it is sort of the culmination of something that I've worked a long time for, and I've been able to do Go Ape and Cal Ripken and so many other wonderful, cool projects, and it's neat to watch it come, things come to fruition, and that's going to be exciting to watch. I think the main thing I want to say is to my co-employees, to the other parks employees, I don't think that I'll ever drive down a greenway and not know what it takes to mow it and edge it and supervise the people who make that happen. I don't think I'll ever drive by one of our facilities and not, maybe it's not a great thing, but have that much information about the infrastructure that makes it happen and work. And maybe I don't want to have my head full of that, but I do. And so it just gives me a very deep appreciation of what my colleagues have done and continue to do. And I will miss a lot of them in that regard, because they really bring such honesty. And you know, Forrest is one of the ones I said you will miss, because he really brings a lot of enthusiasm to his projects. And then lots of other people too. But anyway, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Next order of business, introduction of some interns.
Yes, we are fortunate to have three interns with us today. As you know from past years, commissioners, We strive to have young students here that can learn about our system. At the same time, we learn a lot from them. And Forrest Decker has been coordinating our intern program for the last couple of years, and he will make the introductions.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I'll just have you three stand up, and I'll tell you who they are, and if you'd like to ask them any questions, make it really, really hard, because they're here to work. So first I have Callie Johns on the end here from Kansas Wesleyan University, Bethany Murphy from University of Missouri, Kansas City, and Caitlin Billingsley from the University of Missouri, Kansas City. We're real happy to have them. Callie and Bethany have been on for about a week and a half. Caitlin just started yesterday, was her first day, and we'll have them for 10 to 12 weeks until they go back to school in the fall.
Okay. Great.
Well,
welcome to the team. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Forrest.
Thanks. Moving forward, looking at resolution number 30452.
Yes, Commissioner, this is a cooperative agreement with Cal Ripken Senior Foundation for a project out in the Little Blue Valley Park. This is the fully accessible Ball Diamond project we've talked about in the 5th Council District. You have a memo from Travis in your packet. And Travis is here to answer any questions. And also we have a guest with us today representing the Cal Ripken Senior Foundation. Travis, you want to introduce Bobby?
Thank you, Mark. As you mentioned, we have Bobby McCaffrey with the Cal Ripken Senior Foundation. And Bobby, if you'd like to come up and tell us a little bit about your involvement in the project.
Yes, hello. Thank you for having me. Our involvement with the project here is we started a little over a year ago. We're introduced from Jennifer and Mark to KC Parks and Recreation with this thought of building the two accessible mobility fields, kind of both to kids and National Wheelchair Softball Association. Let's fast forward to where we are today. We have a deed of easement in place. We have preliminary budget, conceptual design, and roughly $300,000 from the city secured, another $100,000 from the foundation, and we're actively talking about bringing in, you know, more potential funders.
Great. Any questions or comments at this time?
It's an exciting project. It's good to see.
Yeah, very good.
Thanks for your help.
Yeah, we appreciate you guys bringing this resource to Kansas City. It's something that I know we need in the city, and we know you've done great work in other parts of the country as well. We hope that this project meets its expectations, and we meet those fundraising goals, and we get these fields built.
Yeah, we're steamrolling right ahead. I met with the Royals this morning, and they have great interest in the project as well. They want to get out and see, and have invited us to apply for October 1 grant deadline so they can put the project in front of their board. So they've been extremely benevolent to the Cal Ripken Senior Foundation to the tune of about $600,000 for three other projects in the greater KC area, both on the Missouri and Kansas side. So we have a standing relationship with them, and we'll be working hard moving forward with our grant writers and the city itself where the funding will go through.
That's great.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. With that, is there a motion to accept the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a
second?
All right. Motion is seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Very good. Resolution passes. Resolution number 30453.
Yes, Commissioner. This is consideration of a contract with the GoAbe LLC. Visa touched on this earlier. This is a contract I've been working on for some time now, having gone out with RFPs and selected this firm to provide us with a treetop adventure course here in Swope Park. Forrest is going to tell us a little bit more about it.
Yes, good afternoon again, Commissioners. Thank you, Denise, for all your help on this, since you're leaving us now. this is going to be a really fun thing up in Swope Park. You've got a memo there that kind of outlines what their responsibilities and our responsibilities are, and I think we have provided you with a packet of some good pictures and some not so good, but a lot of the pictures are really high quality that kind of show some of the obstacles and stations along the course itself. So, you know, some pretty cool stuff up there. This doesn't get built overnight or designed overnight, so this would actually not be in operation until 2016. But we're starting now, almost a year ahead of time, so getting everything into place. Charles Tresky from GoAbe did come out today. If you have any questions for him or I, either one, you know, I'll let Charles say a few words if you don't mind.
Great. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you all very much for allowing GoApe to come out today. We're definitely very excited about the project out here in Kansas City. And also, it's been, you know, a pleasure working with Forrest and Denise kind of here over the last couple weeks, getting everything finalized. You know, you're going to be our 14th course here in the States, so we're very excited about that. And just really looking forward to expanding our partnership with you guys and making sure everybody can GoApe, basically, for Kansas City area. Very good. And happy to answer any questions that you might have regarding.
Any questions, comments?
So you talk about not design like overnight. So the design process happens kind of organically in the sense that as you get in and figure out the certain trees and things like that.
Correct. Yes, we have a preliminary design completed already for the park. We're going to come back out in the fall and do a redesign of it because we'd like to actually design in a little bit more wow factor, a little bit longer zip lines, things of those of that nature. But right now the understory is just so thick, it would be very difficult for us to design something. You know, currently today. So we'll come back out probably, you know, late October, early November, get our sight lines down, and then at that point we'll come back with our final design and for your approval.
Okay.
And probably be operational, you know, early spring of 2016, kind of doing a target goal of March 31st.
To accommodate, like, how many people?
On a weekly basis, or a daily basis, I should say, more about 240 is our max per day. What we do is we limit our participants on the course to 14 per hour during the week, and then on the weekends we do a 30-minute basis of 14 per hour. I mean, think of it like a golf course. You don't want to be necessarily sitting on the tee box waiting for somebody to clear the fairway the whole time. So we limit it to 14, one for instruction, and then also two for traffic flow in and out of the park.
I think Mary Jane stole your question. So.
Yep.
All right, sounds good.
It's exciting.
Great. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Great. We look forward to it. Thank you.
Is there a motion to accept the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Very good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. All right. Resolution number 30454.
Yes, Commissioner, as has been alluded to earlier, consideration of design guidelines, Boulevard Parkway standards. You have a memo in your packet from Travis that outlines the scope, and also there's three attachments with that memo. And I believe Jeff Williams from City Planning is going to give us a little summary along with Patty Knoll.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Jeff Williams, Director of City Planning and Development, here with Patty Knoll. It's going to take you through the ordinance. We were here 2 weeks ago talking with you and the community about parkway and boulevard standards, getting into the nuances of the standards themselves, and really the importance of them in terms of the preservation of the parkway and boulevard system and to provide some clear guidance about its further and future expansion. Patty will go over some highlights of some things that have changed since we were in front of you 2 weeks ago, but one of the things I'd like to leave you with as I turn things over to Patty to go through those details is just the understanding, and some of the recrafting really was focused on the idea that this is a comprehensive system for the city of Kansas City, Missouri. And so somewhat less about north versus south, and really more about the overall context and making sure we preserve those existing assets and resources of the system, and again, have some very clear guidance for the system's further expansion, regardless of that expansion's location within the city. So thinking more less about specific geography and really more about understanding context. And keeping that thought in mind is what led to a number of the different modifications. And again, from our planning department's perspective, we were very happy to be a part of the process working with Denise and Travis and Jimmy and the whole team here. We know that through the adoption of these standards, we'll be able to provide very clear guidance for those people who own property and main property along the Parkway and Boulevard system. Know that we as a city will have a consistent set of standards and a streamlined administrative process to allow people to further develop and improve their properties along the Parkway and Boulevard system. So with that, I'll turn things over to Patty.
Thank you, Jeff.
Good afternoon, Board.
Afternoon.
Staff. The as Jeff noted, the construction of the boulevards and parkways is a major public investment for the city. The expectation, therefore, is that the private development be commensurate with good design materials and architecture. And to that end, we have worked for many years, off and on at certain periods, to come together with this group of use standards and design recommendations for you. The as you have seen before, the packet is divided into two parts, one of which is the land use chart, which recommends that certain uses within 150 feet of the park, boulevard, or parkway system, and I do note that that includes parks, be either permitted, allowed with a special use permit, or prohibited. So we have had agreement with the development community and neighborhoods that we've worked with, and various private and public parties as to that land use table. And that is probably a major part of this whole effort. The second part is the creation of the design standards, which are before you, and you've seen as section 88.323, which will be incorporated directly into the zoning and development code. And those design standards apply to development adjacent to it and within 150 feet of boulevards and parkways, and not parks, just boulevards and parkways. So since the June 2nd board meeting, we have worked with staff and a couple of the board members in discussions and revised the applicability section somewhat that you can see. We, as Jeff said, would like to emphasize again that these standards apply citywide. We have an excellent boulevard and parkway system citywide, and I believe the expectation is among residents north, south, areas that are developed and undeveloped, that that continue and quality development be commensurate with that. So we would like to emphasize that we are not creating certain standards for any portion of the city, but rather that these should apply with some variation citywide. The other change that we've made since we were here June 2nd is to address single family residential one and two family lots that would be adjacent to a boulevard or parkway. We had a provision previously that they could back onto a parkway with provision of an 80-foot landscape buffer tract, and we have as directed by discussions with the board, removed that concept, and current version requires that all one and two family lots would either front or side onto the boulevard or parkway. So those are the two changes that you see in the document before you. As we have worked through this process, most recently with the development community, we have had several discussions. As I said, the land use, the use section is agreed to. For the most part, staff has made some concessions, which include allowing a circulation drive to be located with it between the principal building and the parkway. As you heard last time, the development community desires that there be parking spaces in that area, but staff has agreed to allow a circulation drive only. We have reduced the parking setback for parking that is to be on the side of the building. We have given some understanding to building orientation, understanding that it may not be the main entrance that fronts the parkway, but it could be a customer entrance. And to that end, our standing is that if the main entrance is going to be on the side of the building as opposed to the front of the building, then therefore it is logical that the parking could be on the side as opposed to in the front of the building. The other consensus we've made is to require the development node concept of a development only where two parkways meet, as opposed to where a parkway and an arterial meet, because that would be at the intersection of many intersections. So therefore, what we would do is still allow the development community to have the opportunity at many locations in the city where the development could occur that may or may not meet the boulevard and parkway standards. So as I alluded to, there are still some issues remaining. One is the location of parking. The development community would like to see parking spaces located between the building and the boulevard or parkway right of way. We believe it is so the people with vehicles drive by, they say, oh, there's a parking lot, there's a parking space, I can go there. We are trying to encourage multimodal, complete street concept of development in the city, which would be friendly to not only those arriving in private vehicles, but by bicycle, walking, other modes of transportation. So there will, of course, be access provided to all uses, possibly off an arterial street that intersects with the parkway, but we would like to see there be pedestrian-friendly ease of access from anyone on that public sidewalk, public boulevard, public parkway to the commercial establishment or the residence, whatever the case may be. Again, another point of discussion is that residential lots shall front on the parkway rather than be allowed to back. That concept was presented to you the last time since with the current draft, as I said, that has been retracted. The gasoline and fuel sale remains to be an item of disagreement. The development community contends that gas and fuel sales should be able to face the Boulevard or Parkway. Staff would like to see the pumps, the canopy, everything associated with that function side or back at the back of the building as opposed to fronting on the parkway. And then an issue that came up recently has been in the standards for some time and elsewhere within the ordinance is 60% transparency for buildings, commercial buildings, which means windows glazing doors. There are some other issues that have been raised. We believe that they've been discussed. Again, it revolves around the expectation of architectural design and high quality development along a parkway or boulevard and materials. There are, as I alluded to, several points that the staff developer group and as well neighborhood representatives and others have discussed and agreed to, which are, as I said, the use tables for the most part, four-sided building architecture, the importance of using consistent materials and architecture on all sides of the building, and of course landscaping, berming, and screening is very important between the right-of-way and the vehicular use area. So with that, that concludes my report, and I will take any questions or comments you may have. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions, any comments at this time? No? Thanks very much. Thanks, Patty. Okay. I think we've discussed this several times over. I think we're ready. Is there a motion to accept the resolution?
I would like to offer a motion amendment to our document that we have to generally prohibit gasoline and fuel services on the boulevard and parkways and specifically delete section 88-323-07, which is additional provisions for sites with gasoline and fuel sales. Mm-hmm.
So you're making a motion with that amendment. Is there a second to that motion with the amendment?
Second.
So motion seconded. Questions, any comments? Any other additional changes we'd like to make?
Just one.
Yeah. At this time?
The public?
We allow for at the end of the public hearing. Yeah. Okay. Hearing none. Is there a motion? The motion is seconded with the amendment made by Commissioner Dillingham. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Very good. Any opposed? Just make sure. Okay. Very good. Resolution passes, and Boulevard Parkway standards now move forward to the next process. We will take public testimony at the end, public hearing at the end of the meeting as we normally do. So, okay. Next order of business, resolution number 30455.
Yes, Commissioners, this is a contract or bid recommendation to Waldo Water Tower restoration. As you're aware, we did some work on it back last year, cleaned it up, painted it. This bid would do lighting and fencing around the base. I would recommend approval to Gunter Construction Company. If you have any questions, Travis is here to answer those.
All right. Any questions of Travis in regards to this project? Is there a motion to accept the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion seconded. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Resolution passes. Resolution number 30456.
Yes, Commissioners, Memorandum of Understanding with Spray and Neuter of Kansas City. We've worked with this group over the past several years, actually, and this would be a recommendation to continue to work with their services, as outlined in the memo from Linda Miles. And if you have any questions, Linda's here.
Hello, Linda.
Good afternoon.
Afternoon.
How are you?
Good. You?
Spay and Neuter of Kansas City would like to use Garrison Community Center for off-site facility for vaccinations and microchipping. They have used two other facilities this year. They have been at Hillcrest Community Center and Westport Community Center. They have averaged probably about 40 pets for the three-hour span that they're there, and they want to use Garrison Community Center on June the 27th. So they're looking for to come into an agreement with us.
Very good.
How will you all market this, not market, I guess, but get the word out that you guys are having this? I think it's a great idea. Will the word be spread to the neighbors and the neighboring communities around Garrison?
Yes, they have flyers that they are sending out. Yes, we do have flyers.
Okay.
Great. Any other questions, comments?
This is a neat partnership.
Yeah, very good.
It really is. It really is.
Absolutely.
Yep. Thanks for working with us.
Glad you're doing it.
All right. With that, is there a motion to approve the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you, Linda.
Thanks.
Resolution number 30457.
Yes, Commissioners. This is for board acceptance of the St. Joe Medical Center collection. The acquisition committee has reviewed this under leadership of Anna Marie Tutera. And she has a memo in the packet today recommending acceptance of this collection. We would also support that. And of course, if you have any questions, Anna Marie is here. And maybe she'll tell us a little bit about this collection. What do we got, Anna Marie?
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Good afternoon. We are really excited about this acquisition, not only for the museum, but for Kansas City. It was started in 1971 by Dr. Piper, who kind of enlisted his colleagues to contribute to this medical collection, which is now over 15,000 objects, dating back to as early as the 1800s to the present. It has been curated and inventoried since 1998, and Prime Healthcare has decided to donate it to the Kansas City Museum. So while it focuses on the medical history of St. Joseph's, it has a vast number of objects that actually can be used to interpret local medical history in Kansas City and the doctors that have served us. So Kansas City has a very rich medical history. It was one of the premier medical societies early on in the late 1800s. So we think that this will provide tremendous opportunity to exhibit these materials and work in collaboration with other institutions and hospitals to do so.
Any questions or comments? Is there a motion to accept the resolution?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Resolution number 30458 regarding the acceptance of gifts and contributions.
Yes, Commissioners. Free gifts. Recommend acceptance.
All right. Is there a motion to accept the gifts and contributions?
So moved.
Second. Motion seconded. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
That's easy enough. On to the director's report.
Travis.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Before you have a set of papers, look something like this. It's called the Platte Purchase Park Sewer Main Extension. And this was the sewer main that was put in at the north end of Platte Purchase Park. The mains that went in as part of the First and Second Creek or Twin Creeks sewer expansion program, a $40 million program, also included work that crossed Platte Purchase Park. And as part of that work, an extension of an agreement was reached for $420,000 to extend two lines down into Platte Purchase Park to the south. You can see on the next page there what the preliminary plan showed, the sewer lines. It's about 1,550 feet roughly, and about 400 feet on the other one, a total of 1,950 feet of sewer main, the one on the west running down to the smaller quadrant of fields, and the one to the east is the one you'll see in the photographs later on. There was a slight modification. You can see it originally was supposed to run to the center of the fields down on the west side, and it runs to the west side of the field, and that was to accommodate a creek crossing in that location. On the photograph on the third page, it's a little hard to distinguish, but in the background that picture right about the horizon is the manhole that you see in the lower portion of the picture, so running from this location across, and you see that the height of the field up here running, so it's still a gravity feed sewer in this location running back to the main running at the north edge of the field. And then just a close up of where that extension is, you can see the silt fencing and so forth in the background. That picture, that sewer main is in right now. Platte County Parks and Rec and our staff are working together with Vireo to come up with various connection options for the park itself, where to locate the facilities in the park. So, any questions?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Heidi, marketing report, please.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
We had a really busy weekend. I think 5 events in 3 days, which is thankfully not typical for the summer, but not super unusual. So Friday evening we had the plein air painting contest at the Kansas City Museum, along with the summer outdoor concert. Their second, they have one in July and then August as well. And it was great. We had 15 artists turn out for that first time event, and they painted some beautiful, beautiful stuff. So Central Bank, is it? Anne-Marie.
Central Bank sponsored this.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, Central Bank sponsored the winner, and it's a gorgeous painting. You can see it on Facebook or Instagram. Or in their bank, I guess, is where they're probably going to hang it. So that was another successful event. Then on Saturday, we had maybe not such a successful event. Well, the event was great, but needless to say, the Blazing Paddles, Kansas City Parks and Recreation, Dragon Boat Racing Team, did not do so well.
We didn't win.
I know we received the award at last our last park board meeting, but they didn't back it up, man.
It was a bad omen, I think.
Yeah. So luckily for all of these events, the rain held off all weekend, which was amazing given the forecast. So the 11th Annual Dragon Boat Festival and races were great. Except for our team, and we're going to work on that for next year. And then on Sunday, of course, we had the Ride the Fountains bicycle tour, which we do in cooperation with the Kansas City Metro Bike Club. Good turnout again for that. The rain held off. It was held on the north lawn of the Liberty Memorial this year, which was a beautiful, beautiful venue and location. Great skyline views and the beautiful fountains there as well. And then followed that up with a Flag Day retirement ceremony and celebration in Washington Square Park at the Korean War Veterans Memorial, which again was a lovely, lovely event. So that was last weekend, and then here we go and continue on for this week. We have the Children's Fountain anniversary celebration, and that is on this Friday at 10 o'clock at the Children's Fountain. It's a celebration of 20-year anniversary, as well as an announcement of renovations that will be happening at the fountain. We've received some funds through the City of Fountain's Wish Upon a Fountain campaign that will help fund those. So that's exciting, and there will also be cake at that event. So now I know we need to make more cupcakes since I announced that. You'll like that. Since it's a birthday or anniversary, we're going to celebrate with cake. And then we just have the fishing derby, Urban Kids Fishing Derby at Spring Valley Lake on Saturday. Something that was on your agenda, I guess, last month kind of tentatively, but now has been firmed up, is the kickoff for the Tower Park Water Tower renovations. That's going to be at 9 o'clock in the morning on July the 14th. So there's other things on there as well, and other things on your calendar, which Mark can go over. You guys can read yourself. There is one more thing, though, I want to add. I think Carmen emailed this invitation out to you today. This is the kickoff for the development of the 51st and Oak development project, which I guess is the Whole Foods market that's going to be located there along the trail. So, busy times. Appreciate your support. Come out and see us.
Thanks so much. Okay, on to public hearing. Right now we have three people who are signed up. If there's other people who want to after these three, please just let us know and we'll have you come up. The first one is Jim Rice. Mr. Rice, how are you, sir?
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Commission, Director McHenry. Give you two events, and I'm going to go back in time, but I promise to move forward very rapidly after that. 1869, coming of the Hanover Bridge. 1892, the formation of the Parks Department, the Parks Commission. That first event transformed a raucous frontier town into a city. The second transformed a city into an extraordinary city. Over the next several years after the formation of the department, as you know, the vision of George Kessler was made real, and by 1912, the parks and boulevard system from the river to very near here, on Meyer Boulevard, was essentially completed. Extraordinary feat. Even in today, with today's technology, it would have been an extraordinary feat. Almost miraculous in those days. Over the ensuing years, residents and visitors realized that they were driving or walking on very special thoroughfares. There was nothing like it. It softened the hard edges of the city, calmed kind of the angry sounds of the city, and it provided a development framework for the highest quality development. You can still see it today in the neighborhoods that are adjacent to boulevards, surrounded by boulevards. It is truly the greatest asset, the greatest single asset of the city. In my mind, there is no question about that. And we have many other assets. My point is that didn't happen by accident. It happened because there were standards set forth for the boulevards, how they would be used. Some of us remember the proliferation of signs that said no trucks. But you knew you were on something special when you were on a boulevard. And over the years, the commissions and the city councils and certainly the park staff maintained those boulevards through thick and thin. More than 100 years after that, they are still with us and they are still in great condition. And the neighborhoods that adjoin them are in great condition. We're at now, I think, a similarly historic moment when we have an opportunity to bring our standards into the world of today for a couple reasons. One, we have an opportunity to bring back to their full flower some of our old boulevards, such as Independence Avenue and Linwood Boulevard and Armour Boulevard. And as Mr. Dillingham, Mr. Mecklenburg know, we have another incredibly large area north of the Missouri River, the Northland, which is many years behind the Southland for a lot of reasons in building out their park system. With the adoption of these standards, we will have strong guidelines to form that system and to allow it to help create high quality development in the north as well as the south. My hope is that 50 years from today, one of my grandchildren, one of your grandchildren, might appear before the park board and stand here and extol the virtues of the Parks and Boulevard system, still then, 50 years from now, as great as it is today. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mr. Rice. Next is Eric. Bunch,
I was here. Birch. Hi, Eric Bunch from Bike Walk AC. I am a bicycle and pedestrian advocate, which the pedestrian comes first in my from my perspective. And I first wanted to say thanks to staff and also to the commission here for basically taking a giant step in the right direction for walkability. My biggest criticism of this of the new standards is that it isn't applied to all of the streets in Kansas City, because this is really the first I would say the first codified example of where we have put walkability at the top as our priority. So I first wanted to say thanks for that. But I like to call myself an idealist wrapped in a cynic. So I do have some criticism still of the latest standards. And you did chop out one of them, I believe, with the gas stations. But there are some things inside these new standards that are a bit concerning. First and foremost is the provision for driveways. Driveways will be allowed to be in front of new developments, which is problematic for pedestrians who may be trying to get to the entrance. So that is challenging. One thing, kind of going back to my original point, that why is this so important for walkability is that it's not just about complete streets. I mean, we can put sidewalks on streets, we can put bike lanes on streets, but it's also really important to have the land use right, have the design of that land use right, and putting driveways in front of, or especially parking in front of a new building creates a hazard, but more importantly, it creates a culture that does not really respect walking for transportation. So what we encourage is requiring buildings to be built up to the sidewalk, or if they're not built up to the sidewalk with a setback, the primary entrance really should be unencumbered by driveways and parking, car uses, and should be directly accessible for the pedestrian. So another concern is that it will allow the primary entrance to be on the sides of the building, which is concerning for the same reason as I mentioned earlier, that not having quick, direct, convenient access for the pedestrian from the sidewalk is a concern as well. So if earlier we were talking about gas stations being allowed in, so essentially you could require a pedestrian to have to walk through a fuel pumping area in order to just get to the front door of a convenience store. So the convenience is really only realized by the person in the car and not the person who's walking there. So just another comment in that regard. So there. Again, I will say that a lot of this is really positive. A couple other things that deal with more of the right-of-way. Looks like it's going to still be encouraging really wide streets that are built in the most of them I would assume are going to be built in the Northland with a 200-foot right-of-way requirement. Our fear is that we will continue building four-lane streets, wide four-lane streets that don't necessarily need that type of capacity. The city recently adopted a road diet resolution that says that four-lane streets are not desirable. FHWA, the Federal Highway Administration, is saying that four-lane streets are dangerous for all road users, not just pedestrians, not just bicyclists, but drivers as well. So I'd encourage you to consider the implications of that. Also consider the implications of the ongoing maintenance costs of such large thoroughfares. Although beautiful, there is when we build new things, we have to consider the maintenance cost. And so for every dollar that's spent on mowing grass and trimming trees, that's money that could be spent building trails, building new parks, building out the rest of the parks in the Northland that have yet to been developed. So I would hate to be putting money into maintaining extra wide streets. So that's another thing that I'd recommend taking a look at. But again, that's my cynical side. My optimistic side is simply that this is a fantastic step in the right direction. And as this moves on forward, I would really hope that we can find a way to make these sorts of standards, albeit not the perfect world yet, how can we make these standards apply to other streets as well? And I guess that's as it goes forward. So that's all I have to say. Thank you very much for the step in the right direction.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Next is Carol Winterhout.
Hello. Good afternoon. I'm Carol Winterroad, and I live in the southwest part of the city. I'm president of Center Planning and Development Council, which is a group of neighborhood and homes associations in the southwest part of the city. Our boundaries go from 85th south to the city limits and from state line to the Blue River. Our mission has always been quality development, and along with quality development, there are certain standards that have to be met. We are very concerned about how developments look, how they blend into the city, and particularly with our parks and boulevards, we've got to be extra careful. And I ditto the eloquent response from Jim Rice, north of the river. We all feel that way, that our standards should be the highest possible and the strongest possible. So Center Planning Board has unanimously and strongly recommends you make the strongest recommendations to the next step, which I guess is the City Council, to pass these standards. This current council doesn't have much longer. So if things don't get done by the end of July, I believe the next council will be more responsive to the beauty of the city. I'm sorry I wasn't here to hear Donna Boley's speech a couple weeks ago, but she's certainly a strong supporter of continuing the beauty of the city that we've had from the very beginning. And I think that with all this emphasis on economic development, people are forgetting what the city should look like. We're forgetting the beauty of the city, the landscaping, how things look. So we are 100% with you on recommending these standards. And we certainly appreciate the hard work that our city staff and the board staff and the consultant have done in this area. I've been to several of the meetings, and there's so many details that were worked out and talked about and discussed several times. So anyway, I'm here to support what you're doing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's all who's listed. Is there anybody else who would like to say a few words? Mr. Burke, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mike Burke, Kansas City, north of the river. I always hesitant to follow Jim Rice. He's very eloquent, and his comments about the opening of the Hannibal Bridge, I understand his comments at that opening were also very nice. I want the 7 years is a long time to adopt a policy, and having been part of it off and on for 7 years, starting with some of the other development lawyers who were most concerned about the sweep and some of the one size fits all, this is a process with a happy ending. I said, I'll stick with it as long as Denise does. Denise, Patty Knoll, Travis, whole planning department, Mark, thank you. Because it was a process, and I think we've ended up with a much better document that works not just for people that love the Boulevard and Parkway system, but also people to understand it provides an incentive for economic development in the community, and that we can have both with a good plan. So thanks to all those who worked so hard for last 7 years, and I think you've got a good plan.
Thank you. Would anybody else like to make any comments? Yes, please.
Good afternoon to the distinguished members of the Kansas City Park Board. My name is Joyce Allen, and I am speaking on behalf of four Northland neighborhoods, Normandy Courts, Windsor Hills, Oak Tree, and Oak View. We want to announce our support for the Parkway and Boulevard standards, and we want to encourage the board to stand firm against compromises, particularly compromises of gas stations on parkways. On January 5th, 2012, the Gashland-Nashua area plan was adopted by Mayor Sly James, City Manager Troy Schulte, and the current City Council members. There were also 32 members on the Steering Committee and 15 members on the Technical Committee and 8 City Planning and Staff Development members contributing to this document, and it was considered a victory for all. This document represents a comprehensive plan to provide vision and framework for long-range political policy decisions. The Northland Parkways, particularly Tiffany Springs Parkway, and zoning preferences are clearly defined in this document. But after 3 short years, with big money entering the picture, the compromises, proposed amendments, and rezoning push has begun. On July 7th, the City Plan Commission will hear a proposal by the Quick Trip Corporation to rezone a 33-acre parcel of land located at the focal point intersection of Tiffany Springs Parkway and North Oak Traffic Way. The land is currently zoned residential 80. The hearing is to rezone all acres to MPD or Master Plan Development and amend the Gashland-Nashua Area Plan. The initial development plan proposed by Quick Trip included 63,000 square feet of commercial development and 168 units of high-density residences, joining the 28-pump gas station to complete their master plan. The problem lies with the clarification of Tiffany Springs Parkway. Docket items submitted show Tiffany Springs Parkway stopping short of North Oak and not including this property in the parkway system. Successful rezoning using the wording on the current court documents would mean Quick Trip would not have to abide by parkway and boulevard standards on any of the development phase 1 or phase 2. Tiffany Springs Parkway was clearly defined by every branch of city government long before Quick Trip applied for rezoning of this parcel. The Gashland-Nashua Area Plan shows the parkway extending to North Woodland Avenue, and the Kansas City Parks and Recreation website currently defines Tiffany Springs Parkway as extending to the North Oak intersection, which would include this parcel of land in the parkway system. I can tell you as a resident that Parkway street lighting is currently up and running and goes clear to the North Oak intersection. You can understand our frustration when our own city councilman, Mr. Ed Ford, who approved the Gashland-Nashua Area Plan on January 5th, 2012, now declares the south edge of this property as not resting on a parkway address. His comments came at our neighborhood meeting on June 11th, 2015. I had a phone conversation this past Saturday with Mrs. Anita B. Gorman, and she reminded me of her efforts to stop a used car lot from setting up shop on the southeast corner of North Oak and Vivian. There is a fountain there now, she said. Mrs. Gorman suggested I bring this issue to Mr. Mark McHenry's attention. The White Goss attorneys have been very successful in representing Quick Trip's interest over the last 20 years. It shows because we have 64 Quick Trips in a 25-mile radius of my home, including one just a block from this new proposed location on Tiffany Springs Parkway. The old building will become vacant and most likely a used car lot. I would like to invite the distinguished director and commissioners to take a field trip to see this property that is the last green space of this caliber in the North Oak corridor. Please come to see this property and envision a 28-pump gas station on the corner, fast food restaurants and retail businesses squeezed in and backed by high density housing. Look at the lay of the land, the established trees, and see the potential that thoughtful development could bring out if parkway and boulevard standards were imposed on the entire project on the front end. Please don't let this jewel slip away and become just another strip development like Nolan Road or the southern sections of North Oak. Then, as we can be assured, the city officials will declare, after it is too late, that this section of land indeed was Tiffany Springs Parkway. As Mrs. Gorman has said in the past, land, we can't grow any more of it. Our neighborhoods, filled with single-family homes and townhomes, need to be heard. The 28-pump gas station is not thoughtful development, it is not needed, and it is definitely not unique. Please do not compromise this land. Thank you very much for your time and consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I'm Meg Conger, and in the words of the aforementioned Anita Gorman, once a commissioner, always a commissioner. So I could not let this opportunity go by without speaking to the Parkway and Boulevard standards that, along with Mr. Burke, I was working on 7 years ago as well, from that vantage point. The Parks Department, including the design and standards of our boulevards and parkways, is something that is envied and exemplified across the country. The value these standards add to Kansas City is nearly incalculable. It is imperative that the standards be kept intact. There should not be a set of standards for one part of the city and another set for another part of the city. Each parkway and boulevard, regardless of its location in the city, is deserving of the same high quality as existing boulevards and parkways. And the residents who are fortunate enough to live on one of these streets, and at one time I was one of them, deserve and have the expectation of that same quality. Specifically speaking about the Twin Creeks development, it would be a disservice to the future residents of Twin Creeks to lower the parkway and boulevard standards. City staff is currently working on ways to make the development process, and this means the inclusion of the standards in development, to be a more seamless process. Additional collaboration between parks and city planning staff is being incorporated into the planning process, and that will encourage cooperation to have quality development. The Parkway and Boulevard standards need to be in place to be a part of this collaborative and cooperative process, which will help ensure every parkway and boulevard to be built to the highest quality standards that the city has come to rely on and appreciate for decades. To emphasize, there should not be two sets of parkway and boulevard standards. Creative development plans, forward thinking, and collaborative staff using a set of standards that has served this city well and made us the envy of the nation will help ensure that developing neighborhoods, regardless of their location in the city, will have these roads to be as high quality as the existing ones today. The city has made an enormous investment in our parkways and boulevards. Not now, nor will it ever be the time to decrease the return on that investment. And by reducing the standards for a particular development, that's exactly what we'll be doing. Please keep whole the parkway and boulevard standards. Thank you.
Time. Anybody else? Peter?
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Although I was here a couple weeks ago, I simply wanted to underscore at representing Peter Sloan with current president of the American Institute of Architects, and our board is strongly behind this thing and further echoes the value of the built environment, and these standards are critical for the future of Kansas City, of elevating design and keeping the standard but our history of our city to be our future of our city. So thanks again for doing this and supporting this, and from our perspective, our board is fully behind it, so thank you.
Right. Thank you very much. Any other comments from the public? Do you want to say something?
Yeah, I'd like to say a couple of things. I'm, like Jim, kind of outspoken, but I will disagree with Jim on one issue. He's said that Alan and I were representatives of the Northland. We are not. We are representatives of the city of Kansas City, Missouri. I particularly am encouraged by the statements from the southern part of the city, understanding that their development has the potential that we have in the Northland, and that those standards of boulevards and parkways are equally, if not more, important to them than they are north of the river. Our idea, as we've gone through this for the last several months, is to develop the standards that are applicable to the entire city, north, south, east, and west, and for the redevelopment around our existing parkways and boulevards as that may occur. We do not want to jeopardize those things that have been here over the many years by allowing them to be eroded for new development. So we're looking not only at the historical significance and the potential redevelopment along those historical boulevards and parkways, but we're looking also at the citywide increased new development, which will continue to make Kansas City an example to the nation of how a city within a park is developed and maintained.
Any other comments? I just want to say, to the point of what's next, from here on the Parkway and Boulevard standards, it actually goes to City Planning Commission. The City Planning Commission, their meeting is on July 7th, right? And at what time? We'll find that out.
Yeah. We'll let you know.
Yeah,
we'll in the morning, more likely.
In the morning, mostly in the morning. Sometime after
9:30. So it'll go there. After that, it will go to the Plans, Zoning, and Economic Development Committee at the part of City Council, and then after that, hopefully, it'll make its way to City Council. So all of you have expressed support, and those of you who have expressed another opinion, we encourage you to be there to say what you would like to say, to let the members of the CPC, the members of the City Council, hear where you all are coming from. Either way, wherever you stand, we will be there, echoing our comments that we had today, supporting what we just passed out of this commission here today. We thank everybody who's worked on these for 7 years, past commissioners, past staff, current commissioners, volunteers, citizens, everybody who's been a part of this. And so we thank you very much. We believe this is an important step in the right direction. It's not a perfect document. I don't believe there is such a thing, but what it is definitely something to keep intact for and try to keep intact the legacy of our Parkway and Boulevard system. So thank you all once again for your testimony and for your support and your ongoing commitment to the City of Kansas City, Missouri. So with that, we're going to go ahead and do the last order of business, which is the calendar review.
Yes, commissioners, a couple things. This is our last scheduled meeting for the month of June. Starlight Theater Board meeting tomorrow morning, the 18th, this Thursday at 7:30. I will remind the board that we do have a planning workshop on the morning of the 22nd. I believe that's been sent out to everyone over at International Architects Atelier's offices on Broadway. Starts at 8 o'clock, I believe. And then FOTS Board meeting on the 24th. And that'll wrap us up to the month of June.
All right. Very good. Anything else for the good of the order?
No.
All right. Hearing none. Meeting is adjourned. Thank you all.
Thanks.
Thank you.